How come? Consequences. No more money, no more job, yeah? No money, no honey. So when we take a look at that, you know, when we understand it, as we give unto the Lord willingly, God loves to give us back more than we can ever anticipate. Says Byron, I want Byron to come up. Okay, he's becoming a dear friend, and you know, he got the Manila madness. He drank the ice cubes, I guess, in Manila, and he got the Montezuma's Revenge Manila style. See? Then, but he went and he went to Metro Manila, he went to Cebu and to Luag, and he came back with a wonderful story. How about a hand for Brother Byron Lau?
Aloha, God's Ohana. Just privileged to be here and just in the presence of God and to share my experience, my trip in the Philippines. Let's see if we got some pics going on. So basically, I said God put on my heart to go somewhere, and I could have went to Canada, Japan, but the Philippines had the biggest need, and I just listened to God, and I hope it was an open door and didn't push it open. But here we have the two places I stayed at the condo. It's time for me to just reflect and do devotions. This is actually CBN Christian Broadcast Network in Quezon City, just in Manila. And this is one of the medical missions I hooked up with Hawaii Medical Missions. And this is one gal, she had a second degree burn along her leg. And she was so brave to just endure that moment. And then she's there with her auntie. So there's a lot of poverty. A lot of times the residents, they are afraid to go to get medical treatment because they can't afford it. They don't want to find out the bad news. And just a little local Thai food, actually. It's like a loco moco. And then this is Pastor Nolan Galito. He's with Hope Chapel Metro, affiliated with Hope Chapel West Oahu, with Mike Kai. And the next slide would be Pastor DJ and his wife up in Quezon City as well. They're just a bunch of gang that just has a heart for God. And one of the youth leaders, Val. I was staying at the World Vision Missionary House, and that's where I bumped into all these awesome people. Pastor Mike as well, and his wife, Brother Steve from Oahu with the medical mission. And up to Luag, arrived solo. I'm on this trip by myself, and I'm thinking, what am I doing, God? You're leading me here to serve. Just use me in whatever way you can, in whatever capacity. This is one of the small churches that we met up with, Pastor Charlie and his wife, Thelma. So he took me all around to the different churches. There's churches 2-3 hour drive. And it's amazing. Little hollow, hollow. Watch out for the ice, though, yeah. That's still... I don't know what I was doing. Can advance. So we were at one of the malls. Filipino Independence Day is celebrated something like the 15th or something in June. And me and Pastor Charlie Ortel. He really was gracious in allowing me to stay at his place. We did some sightseeing. My apologies, I did a movie trailer and it didn't come out, so you get to see all 85 slides. Just a resort. It's like, how does that apply? So in missions, there is, you know, you appreciate God's beauty along the way, but really I went up there to just see the people and see how I can learn their culture and be a blessing. God used me as a blessing to them, as well as the pastors. This is one of the, I think it's consulate where former President Aquino We already had all the meetings. And a little post. This is a rice field. We're headed up to the mountains. And it's amazing how the workers go to work. A lot of them don't have transportation, so they need to walk to work. And that might take 2 to 3 hours just to get from point A to point B and back home. A lot of them, they have these signs, you're entering this baranga, I think you call it. So we're headed up to the mountains. This is one of the churches that is being developed. They got the foundation and the roof up, and they're just awaiting more funds. And a few of the gang that rode up with us. Can you advance the slides a little fast? Yeah, there you go. Need to learn how to crop. So it's a very small church, but it's amazing that what I felt was their heart for God is, no matter where you are in the world, we all serve the same God. No matter if you have a different language, you look different or whatnot, we're all here serving God on the same capacity. Their heart for God is amazing. It is humbling. And passing a river on the bridge as well. Even went swimming in the water, and I don't know if that's advisable. They're doing their laundry upstream, so. We're at another church. Pastor Arnell, the top right in the purple, he has led this church for several years. And, you know, the pastors, it's all about supporting the pastors. You ultimately should support your own church first and the pastors there, and then reach beyond. But sometimes their salary is a big zero, so I really don't know how they pay their water and electricity. It's really leaning on God and having faith that He'll provide. This is sponsored by Hawaii, actually, the next village that comes up. Just one of the gang from Pastor Charlie. I don't know how she's related. They had their birthday. This is her niece, his niece, Honey Girl. And this is actually their house that I'm helping to sponsor, because they live with very little resources, and sometimes it's very humbling that what we have, they don't have, and they don't look to have stuff. It's just they're content with the very little that they do have. So this is her family as well. The key thing is that they really strive for education to get advancement, better opportunities. A little Christian bookstore, we picked up a couple of Bibles to share with some of the members that were less fortunate. One of the music stores picked up an electric guitar for Honey Lynn. She does praise and worship, and she's a little gal, and a full-size guitar she's like playing, so we got her something that's more resourceful. And this is Pastor Charlie's daughter, Naomi, in their front of their house, and their doggies. I think the next slide is their district office, a little hut, which they keep in contact, and everything's accountable at that point, at that location. It was Father's Day at that weekend, so all the fathers were honored. Everybody had a good Father's Day back? You see? I think you gotta cut them, yeah. Yeah.
Tell you what, there's a lot more pictures, but a little bit of time. But can you tell us one thing God spoke to you about when you went to the Philippines? You went there for a purpose. He opened the doors. And what did He say to you when you were there?
Basically, what God was putting on my heart is to really reach out to people in need. We have needs here in Hawaii, but you can't imagine the poverty up in the Philippines. It's so amazing. I think what it is actually just open your heart and just look at the needs of others. Sometimes we want to focus on ourselves and what do we need, what do we want, but really is how can we serve God through ministry in the Philippines and reaching out to others.
Thank you.
Thank you.
when you get the movie going, we'll show it, okay? The reason I asked Mark to be here, because he has really a heart for missions. And our missions team in Bali is going through some mean spiritual warfare there, and they need our prayers. Even in our sister church in Luwak and down in Kamandingan and all the way in Pangasinan. So I think Byron had seen that firsthand. And he always, when we were discussing things about missions, he really wanted to get involved with something. So our church, our little church, is making a huge difference internationally. So that's really exciting. So the what you give as far as, you saw this fish trap, eh? You went down to Vintara, you saw this. And that she went to Panili, that little the pastor there. He went to Ventar with Pastor Rose. And they saw the little things that mean a lot. So the few cents that you put inside, we call it change for change. Okay, the change that you find in your pockets, under your couch, whatever it is, you put in here, and God will increase that. So Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we give to missions because your goal is none shall perish. So the change that we put in here, fishers of men, will really bring people who don't know you into the kingdom of God. That's our major purpose, Father. We thank you. We get to do this for you in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen?
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Thank
you. Byron, thank you so much. Thank you so much for doing it. And I look forward to working with you. And for those of you who have a heart for missions, okay, we want to really gather some people together and really make a difference. One of my biggest goals is to send a team from this church to meet some of the people that Byron met. They're going to blow their mind, yeah?
Actually, now we have a team of three gals that are available
right now. Good. How's, I'd like to get with Pastor Marcus and you and see how we can support the Philippines, the pastors there. So let's connect a little bit later, okay? Okay. This is the fun part. I get to share the Word of God with you guys. And what we really want is have a balance between the spiritual and the practical. Amen to that? Okay. Knowing the Word of God and doing the Word of God will bring what? Change in your life. Okay? And if you don't change, whose fault is it? Yeah, I used to blame my wife all the time. Oh, Lord, this woman you gave me. Yeah, your fault, Lord, all that. But, you know, we're going to really talk stories a little bit, and we're going to try to go to the Word of God and see what God says about this, right? How many of you blame your spouses?
Oh, yeah.
Has it worked yet?
No.
Don't go there, right? So when I started to write this, it was so fun for me because we all go through it. We all go through it. Some more extreme than others. Amen to that? Okay. You blame your husband, your wife, your boss, your pastor. You blame everybody else. But, you know, when we sing the song, Change My Heart, O God, it's my heart, O God. Not change my, Jane Keats' heart, O God. God thinks some things are impossible, but that's okay, right? So when we take a look at this, okay, the title of the message today is Don't Go There. Okay, danger. Don't go there. How many of you, okay, God says, don't go there, but you still go there? Oh, my Lord. Isn't it an unpleasant thing when you don't listen to God? Okay, but how do you transform? How does God transform our blunders into blessings? Because most of us belong to the bus up ministry, right? We all bus up, right? Because we make really bad choices in our life. But God redeems that. Okay, there are many warning signs, like stop. How many of you stop? Okay. How about wet paint? How about use crosswalk? Or hospital zone, be quiet, eh? Or high surf warnings. Okay, there are many warning signs on product, on medicines, that were telling us of the possible side effects. Sometimes the side effects worse than the cure, yeah? Oh, you might get cancer, you might get this, you might get that. Right? There are warning signals we give to our children. What kind of warning signals do you give to your children? Shh. Right, Mandy? Amen. Many times a day. Warning signs like wives give their husbands. Don't go there. Right? Warning signs usually means caution. pay closer attention or don't go beyond this point of no return. And some of us have breached that warning many, many times. Trouble usually happens when we don't see, ignore, or refuse to see the warning signals. Okay? Ignorance is no excuse, by the way. Okay? So, we touch wet paint to see how wet it is. Okay? We speed up when the light turns from green to yellow. And we get caught at intersections. Okay? We cross the streets where it's most convenient for us, even though the crosswalk is right over there. Especially in the Philippines, right? No more crosswalks, just whatever it takes. Okay? Or high surf warnings. Tourists, we love to watch tourists at a sandy beach. Yeah, they think they can handle the shore breaks, and we put up chairs and we watch them take a beating. And we laugh and laugh, lose their bathing suits, lose their rings, and we're cracking up because why? High surf current, no go in. If you're not, you know what? Nah, we can handle. We swam at Lake Superior. Right? So when you take a look at that, what are some of the warning signals? We put kids on timeout because you got it up to here. Right, moms and dads? The dog whisperer, right? Okay, we try to distract them. Mercy, forgiveness, compromise is the last thing we want to do or give. We really want to get the last word in our arguments. Men, have you won? Have you put in your last word? Doesn't work, right? It's good to be still. What is really important in Psalms 46:10, okay, if you want a peaceful life, this is what God says. Be still, know that I am God, not you. I am in control totally, not you. This is what the scripture means, to be still, to pay attention to what God is saying. Okay, he's telling us that he specializes in the impossible things. Okay, sometimes we want to get in God's way. Okay, we give God permission, but we want to give him advice, put in our 2 cents. It doesn't work that way. Okay, God says, you know what? I am God. There's no higher thing. There's no higher authority than me. Okay, I am the source of all wisdom. I control everything. Everything is in place because of my word. So why should you give God advice? I know I did. And he delayed answering me. The question we struggle with is, do we really trust God to handle our problems? Do we? I didn't. Why? Because I wanted God to answer my questions my way, not his way. Why? Because we're counterculture. When God says something and we get, I know, yeah, but. I know. Yeah, but 4 words that get you in real deep kimchi. Okay? God knows everything. Okay? So, are we intentionally listening to God? How many of us get distracted? Only, you know, somebody's talking, but we're not listening, so we're really conjuring up what we're going to say, and we never listen. Right? Okay, listening is intentional hearing. Paying attention. This is why I tell Keith, look what I, brother, look what I, all the time. Okay, why? I want full attention. If God comes, okay, if you're coming to church just to hear a message, it won't work. You got to come to hear answers to the questions that you have. You got to come hungry and thirsty, not come to church just to take up space, just because of obligation. No, you want the presence of God, his wisdom, spoken through your pastor, spoken to a praise and worship, or whatever, to hit your heart, from his heart to my voice to your heart. So what is the message? God is always speaking. God spoke to me clearly when I was away from church. Because we don't go to church, we are the church. Does that make sense? So God is speaking not only through the pastor, speaking to you individually. It's not the pastor who has authority, it's God who has authority to speak his spoken word into your life so there's change in your life or modifications in your life. So sometimes it's, oh, Pastor, I'm not being fed. Feed yourself. Amen? Okay, Because I'm not here to force feed you. You're here to hear God's word and just not to, this is just surface level. I want you to go deeper into your conversations with God. Go into the word, start to pray, and go into small groups. What is God saying to you? Okay, not what the pastor says. What is God saying to you? And some of us come to Sundays. You know, I've been preaching for many, many, many years. And it's redundant sometimes. And you know, your kids, sometimes we talk to your kids and said, oh, I heard it before. Here we go again. Right? How many of you? Yeah. Here we go. Yeah, same old song. Right? Let's try a different key this time. But God's word is redundant, is same yesterday, today, and forever. And he repeats himself over and over and over again. Okay? If you heard it before, maybe a better question would be, were you listening? Were you? What did I say? So when I ask people, what is God saying in your life? Well, I don't know. Ah, how come? Okay, now, what's really important is God is so cool. We got stuck in L.A. in standby, right? We're sitting there, and I'm playing the Woe Is Me game. Oh, we miss another flight. Oh, no, here you go. Okay, we miss, and we slept over at gate 25, right? I said, Lord, there is something, got to be a blessing in this bummer, right? And a friend of ours comes walking with an orange shirt on at LA airport, and he goes, hey, Nando, God had a plan. The reason why we missed those flights is because God wanted me to minister to his heart. He was going through certain things in his life. He said, I've been in church for 19 years, but never read the Bible. Coming to church doesn't make you a Christian. Like sitting in a car, you know, a garage doesn't make you a car, right? What is God saying? He goes, I don't know. I says, how come? Oh, because I never read. Oh, how come you don't read? Because I don't understand. Why don't you understand? Because I'm lazy. Ah, there it is. So I ministered to him, and you know what? Little things. I said, brother, consider this. He went, boom! There was a God moment. Okay, why did God send us all the way to Los Angeles? I could have spoken to him here because, you know, we see him once in a while, but why did God take him all the way to California, stuck at the airport so that I could speak to him? Revelation. God is good, I tell you what. So, real change comes when you heed the warning signals. If God says, don't go there, don't go there. It's just like when the doctor tells you, you got to alter your eating habits, you got to lose weight, okay? You got to do this, you got to do that, or you're going to die. What are you going to do? You better do something because you're going to die. You know what that's called? Consequences. Okay? But God says, I want you to obey me through blessings, not consequences. Does that make sense? Okay? I tell our kids, if you want good things to happen, do good things. Eventually, good things will happen to you. You want to have bad things happen to you, guess what? Continue to do what you're doing. Do bad things happen. So if there is need changes in your life, whether it be your health, maybe your finances, maybe relationships, if you are not being changed, if you're not being altered, okay, according to God's word, it's not God's fault. I remember going before God and said, you know what, God, I'm complaining. And you know, say, you know, God, da 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 da, and you know what? And you know what God goes? And he goes, and? That's all he has to say. He looks at you and goes, and? Okay, so if there's nothing wrong with God, nothing wrong with his word, nothing wrong with Jesus, nothing wrong with the ministering angels, nothing, then who's at fault? I had to own up. I had to swallow my pride and say, Lord, fix me, please. Okay? Not anything around me, not my wife, not my family, not my church, not my friends, not my neighbors, nothing else. Fix me, Lord. And once he started to fix me, then I started to have a new perspective on life. Why? Because I took responsibility and no one else. Amen? Okay? So sometimes we look at people and we can see their flaws, but we can't see our own. Why? Because, okay, I am perfect. I thought so till Lilia said no. Okay, but there's another step, okay? Knowing what to do and doing what you know. Okay, the application is really important. I don't want you to be an educated derelict. I want you to have revelation and change in your life. Okay, listening intentionally with God. God says faith without works is dead. No sense you get all this education, but you don't use that education or that revelation or the experiences for the good of yourself or for the good of others. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's really important. God has the answers to every problem. So do we pray? Do we communicate with God? Do we ask? Remember, the answer is always no if you don't ask. Okay, learn to ask good questions. God will always ask you questions about, when you read the Bible, when you study the Bible, you find out that the Bible studies you. And you look at it and go, oh, get busted. Why? Because it's between you and God, right? Only He knows your heart. Okay, you can waha all you want on the outside. You can talk Christianese. You can carry the Bible. You can go to church. But God looks at your heart. He says, okay, how many of you who are married, okay, know your spouses intimately? What they say and what they do don't match sometimes. Yeah? And you look at them and go, You cannot shuck and jive God. He knows you because He formed you in your mother's womb. So we can be still physically, but mentally we're still going nuts, right? We're thinking about things, we think what to say, and we paint ourselves into a corner. Okay? Do we want to do it or do we have to do it? Two different things. When you want to do it, you change. When you have to do it, you won't. When you have to do it because it's under pressure, it's under compulsion, it's under, you know, somebody else's opinion. But when you want to change, then it's a personal thing with you. Then you take personal responsibility to do that. What is God saying to you? Is He saying, slow down, listen to me, listen to my still quiet voice? Because one whisper from God can change your life instantaneously. It did me. Because I was a doer. How many of you are doers? Gotta do something, gotta do, always in a hurry, gotta do something. And we are, and God says, it's not by works, but by His grace. I never read that part real well. Because look what am I doing, Lord. I'm doing ministry, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. But how good am I, God? And God goes, I didn't ask you to do that. Oh, really? So I wasted my time being busy, being unproductive because I was not doing what God had called me to do. I was doing the things that I wanted to do. Two different things. I'll be talking about that last week. Okay? Do what God has gifted you, okay, passionately. Once you work in your passion and your giftings, you don't have to work for the rest of your life. You wake up in the morning, woohoo! Man, I tell you what, it's going to be exciting. Don't chase money. Follow your calling. What is God calling you to do? Okay? When I answered God's call to be a pastor, I had all the excuses in the world not to. I was too busy. I was doing this. For the Lord, God goes, oh, really? And then when I said yes, it was the most difficult decision I had to make, becoming a pastor, because I didn't qualify. I hated people making excuses. I was a drill sergeant, right? It is the most fulfilling thing you'll ever do when you're in God's calling, no matter how difficult it is. Sometimes I'd rather go play golf Sunday. Ooh, man, I like playing golf on Sunday. But you know what? But my calling is higher than my enjoyment. Seeing lives change is more important to me than anything else in the world today. Watching your lives change by the Word of God and having to participate as God uses me as a tool to minister is exciting to me. I've spoken, I've taught in many venues, big, small, whatever it is, but there's nothing like representing God one-on-one. As I sit down and Keith and I converse and, you know, we talk stories and watching his life change is just so exciting to me, okay? When I see him change, I know I have hope. If God can change him, he can change anybody, right? Because we know how pilau we were before. Okay, but God changed our hearts. So God always has time for us. Okay? Always has time. He never leaves, never forsakes. He's always talking to us. He desires to be with us. But do we desire to be with him? Is it an inconvenience to speak with him, to pray, to read his word, to be in his presence? Do you have other things more important than to sit with in the presence of God Almighty? Think about that. The creator of the universe says, Vi, can we talk stories? I just want to spend time with you. Can I love on you, Glenn? Yeah, Byron, thanks, eh? Can you go to the Philippines? Can you be a conduit of my blessings? Mandy, I'm so proud of you. Thank you so much for serving the Lord. Giving, you know, little things for the people in the Philippines, for the, you know, little folder paper here, little bowls here, that's going to mean a lot. Because when they eat, guess what? They'll know the presence of God. Thank you so much for serving the Lord. Wouldn't that be exciting? Yeah, you're seeing Kyle back there, Miss Excitement, walks in. Ah! Oh, big noise again. Yay! Why? We get to spend the rest of eternity with each other. Right, Kyle? Yee. Guess what? We'll spend eternity starting today. Isn't it cool when you can do something like that? So it's so important that we understand that the bummers in life is not the final word in life. It's just a speed bump as far as I'm concerned. So God will redeem those things. Okay, but God will allow problems in life, especially when you're hot-headed. How many of you hot-headed? Raise your hands. Some of you are so hot-headed, you don't like raise your hands, right? Okay, that's cool. Right? We look at somebody as your fault. If the world was perfect, it'd be just like me, right? Wrong. Doesn't work that way. But God will allow storms and troubles in our lives. Okay, I call it for three different reasons. These three different kinds of storms. One, these troubles or storms are indicators that we have done something that we're not supposed to do. We went there, right? God says, stop, later, okay? Wet paint, let me touch it, okay? We speed through the intersections of life. God allows storms, number one, to correct us because we headed in the wrong direction. So there's storms in life. For me, it was, okay, a triple bypass. What has to happen in your life so that you can give God your full attention? Man, I was charging, man. I was doing things for God. You know, man, one of those things? For country. And God goes, oh, really? Okay. So he allowed this in my life so that I could stop what I was doing. Okay, remember this. God will speak to you in any language you will understand. I gave this illustration before. If Kaya was running into traffic, okay, little Kaya, would you say, well, Kaya boy, can you not run into traffic because you might get run over? Would that work with a little child? Or stop! Sometimes God has to speak to me that he puts storms in my life. He says, Nando, stop! Lolo alert! Lolo alert. Because why? Because I was getting into trouble. Put a storm in my life. Or it could be a storm of protection. To protect you from not going there anymore. Okay? So when I looked at that, because I was in ministry, but I was not listening to God very carefully. I was a Christian, but not doing really good Christian stuff. I was doing things for God without God's permission. So God had to protect me from myself. Then there are perfecting storms. Perfecting storms is just to shape you to be more like Jesus. Any character flaws he puts in your way so that he perfects you to be more useful for the kingdom of God as he prepares you for his use. So whatever you're going through now, you went through a perfecting storm. Yeah, I've talked to Byron, he went through all kinds of storms. But now God is reshaping you, right, Byron? And that's really exciting for me to see that. Okay, there are times when God will isolate us, so we have to be still. There's no other option. Why? Because he wants total attention. Total attention. Okay? And sometimes if we don't listen to him, when he says something like, Nando, you better change your diet, man. My cholesterol level, nurses, was 525, the highest ever recorded on the island of Kauai. I had several minor heart attacks that I didn't know. You know, I was so stubborn, I was so strong, I took aspirin so that it temporarily took it away. Never work. But God put that storm in my life, and when I went to the doctor, he says, next week you will have surgery. Uh-oh. It was that bad because of denial, because of my pride. What would people think about me? Okay? Who cares? What does God think about you is better. Amen to that? Okay? When I didn't have a good job, I complained. God, you know what? I prayed for a better job. I need more money. I need da-da-da-da-da. And God goes, oh, really? If you're not content with what you have now, what makes you think you'd be content with something else? Uh-oh. Make sense? So that's relative. Being content is being satisfied with what God has given you at this point in life. Because it's a perfecting storm, maybe, or a storm of correction that he puts you in a certain place that you have to depend on him and nothing else. Not money, not fame, not fortune. God. I know I had to, because I was so stuck on stupid. My foolish pride. There's a life, lots of life circumstances to be still know God. You know, that those things. Okay, maybe a prolonged sickness can be one of those, be still, know I am God. Moving to a new place or joining a new church where you don't know anyone could be one. Being stuck in a miserable or boring job instead of having a fulfilling career that you have hope for could be one. A rebellious or stubborn child, anybody can relate to that. Maybe you are one right now, okay? Or an unbelieving spouse, money problems, heartbreak, broken cars, broken promises are places where doubt and fear seems endless with no hope. Or maybe being still is just a mirage. We can ignore the don't go there signs, deny they exist, or just say, God, I need your help. If you look in your notes, it says Deuteronomy 8:1-7. I love this scripture. Okay, you can read it, but let me put a synopsis on this. Okay, how does God transform our blunders into blessings? Okay, number one, blunders bring us to our knees and open our hearts. Remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness, okay, for these 40 years, humbling you and testing you to approve your character. Blunders will reveal your character or the lack of it. How do you handle those things when you blunder? And to find out whether or not you obey his commands. Are you saying or doing? Knowing and doing. Faith and works working together. They'll bring breakthrough. Number two, blunders teach us to live by God's instructions. Yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry, then feeding you with manna, a food previously unknown to you and your ancestors. He did it to teach you that people do not live by bread alone. Rather, we live by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Amen? What is God saying to you? That's your survival. When we talk about this, it's the air I breathe. Okay? Your holy presence living in me. My daily bread. Do you hunger? Do you hunger every morning for fresh manna? Every morning. Not regurgitated stuff. Fresh stuff. Fresh manna pua. You know what I mean? Fresh banana bread. That kind of stuff. Really exciting. There's nothing like the smell of fresh bread, right? Oh, I tell you what. You drive by Love's Bakery. Ooh, you start to savor, right? We went down to this donut place in Fallbrook. Oh, the fresh donuts. And we made friends with them, and they gave us free donuts and everything. Oh, there's nothing like freshness. Do you want to eat stale bread? Yeah? Get mold on top and all that kind of stuff, right? I've been there. Okay? But you want to wake up early in the morning, smell the freshness of this fresh manna, and ready to eat, and you savoring at the mouth. Oh, I tell you what, there's nothing like it. Experiencing God's grace personally every single morning. Okay? Instructions. We're not to pick and choose scriptures that we like, you know. Okay? Every word of God that comes from His mouth is for us. It's not, this is for Terry, this is for me, this is for Heather. Oh, Heather, this is all yours. Mine, this is mine over here. Okay, mine, oh yeah, you need all of these scriptures. And don't go to scriptures that you're comfortable with. Okay, a lot of us just go to Proverbs. Easy to read, yeah? Read, yeah? Yeah, you go to John. Okay, try to go to Obadiah once in a while. Oh my goodness, go to Chronicles. See if that messes up your mind a little bit. But it's so rich with God's understandings inside of there. Remember, it's total compliance, not selective obedience. Okay, and doing the same things continually, over and over and over again, and working harder at the things don't work is called insanity. Amen? So if it's not working for you, okay, maybe you should do something different. Okay, maybe you spend a little bit more time. I told my friend, he says, oh, you know, it's so hard reading the Bible all the time, you know, because, oh, I don't understand. I said, you know what, get a picture Bible. Okay, I got one. Okay, get pictures. I look at Samson, you know, I look at David and Goliath. Oh, that's really interesting because men like to look at pictures, amen? We know like read, yeah? So I started with that. Then I got a Living Bible, okay? I got the Message Bible. Then I started to understand. I said, you know what you do, okay? This is what you do. Read 5 minutes. Can you read 5 minutes? Yeah, I can do that. That's all. One day, 5 minutes. Okay, next month, can you read 6 minutes? Yeah, I can do that. And after a while, I started to change. Then I started to hunger. Okay, God says, taste to me. See if I'm good. Oh, man. Then now I get stuck sometimes just reading God's word. You know what's really exciting? Watching my wife and my daughter and my son doing devotions together. Okay, I called on Davin. Brian, I tell you what, he's a prayer warrior. He loves the word of God. Okay. And the question to ask him, yes, my kids, what is God saying to you? Okay? So that's really, really important. Number three, blunders teaches us that God is our provider, not our jobs, not anything else, not our husband, not our wife, not the big lottery, not playing Olympic in golf. Okay, God provides for every need. For all these 40 years, your clothes didn't wear out and your feet didn't blister or swell. Isn't it wonderful when God provides those things? Philippians 4:19 says, God will supply all of your needs. Okay? God will. Nothing else. Only God will. Not might. Okay? All. Not some. All of your needs, not wants. God knows, and God will, if you do what God tells you to do, you will have those. If you don't, you won't. That's how simple it is. Blunders teaches us to fear and obey God. Okay? I needed to yell to the Lord because I blundered. There's nowhere else to go. Nobody else helped me. You know, when I had money, I had plenty honey. I had plenty friends. I didn't have money. Guess what? They somehow disappeared. They said that I'm going to support you, but they weren't there. Okay? Think about it. Just as a parent disciplines a child, the Lord your God disciplines you for your own good. So obey the commands of the Lord your God by walking in His ways and fearing Him. Know what to do and do what you know. That's what God is saying. Okay? And number five, this is really cool. Okay? There is life after our blunders. There is life. No matter how jammed up we are, God will, you know, just like if you have lemons, make lemonade. God takes a look at our blunders. He switches that around, and it's disguised. Take a look at what I'm going through. I tell you what, all of these things right now that I've gone through, all the hurt that I have, all the bad choices, God redeemed that so that I could be a blessing to others because of my terrible experiences. On the other side of the desert, you find why God did what He did. Hindsight is 20/20. You go, God, you good man. This is what happened. No wonder that happened in my life. Okay? Why? Because I made a bad decision, or because I made a good decision, or because I listened to you, or because I didn't listen to you. So when you look back, okay, remember this, wisdom comes from looking back at life, but life got to be lived going forward. Okay? That's really, really important that you understand this. Okay? God is always intentional. Okay? The Lord your God brings you into a good land of flowing streams and pools of water with fountains and springs that gushes out from the valleys and hills. Okay? Gushes, overflowing, just like a fountain. The blessings will come if we just do what God tells us to do. Okay? So that's really important. So remember this, God is always intentional about everything he chooses to do. Nothing just happens. God is very, very, very intentional. God is trying to call me, I guess. Okay? So, what to do in your blunder? Okay, some of you are there right now, right? I made a mistake. What do you do? Number one, trust God, not your emotions. Always trust God. Is there any kind of sin or bad habits or an attitude that God wants to change in your life, but you're resisting? The longer you resist, the longer you delay, okay, the longer you will wait for a breakthrough. Simple as that. How many of you have told your kids that? If you don't listen, you're not going to be blessed. Simple as that, okay? It's important to discern whether the blunders we're experiencing is a result of God disciplining us for our bad choices, or is he preparing us to be used for a higher purpose. As I look back in my life, all the things I went through, all the hardships, the spiritual warfare, okay, all the disappointments, all the ups and downs, God was preparing me for a higher calling in my life. I couldn't relate to people in the Philippines or in Bali or my church members if God didn't allow me to experience the things that we went through, the sins that I've made, the mistakes that I made. He redeemed all of that, the spiritual warfare we have experienced. Now, I can look back at that, and when some people talk about the things they're going through, I go, aha, been there, did that. And this is how I went through it with God. Make sense? So when you sit with God, it's just like being a good attorney. If he is a very good attorney and you can trust him, okay, with some legal things, I'd go, hey, Francis, what about this? How can I handle this? And Francis, been there, did that. And this is how you go, and this is the route that you go. Why? We don't want to be wandering in a desert, right? We want to go to the source of all things. Remember this, don't trust your feelings. Trust God. The devil will meet you at your blunder. And he says, you know what? You blew it. Bail out. God cannot use you. You're so junk. Da, 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 da. And when we start to listen to that, then we start to believe that because we repeat it over and over and over again. So you want to surround yourself with company. Say, Keith, you're growing, man. I tell you what. Tane, man, God is using you, man. Okay, Dion, right on. Right on, right? Sometimes you know that you're blocked. My wife is like that. Ooh, and sometimes I'm my worst, best enemy. Anybody like that? But God's, oh, God, that's okay. God forgive you. He's using, I don't want to hear it, you know what I mean? But she is the one, the source of encouragement. We all need our Barnabases, right? We need somebody to come alongside and say, Sharon, good job, man. Keep going. Okay? I screwed up. I know. Me too. Been there. Ted, keep on keeping on, man. I tell you what. Why? Because we have a God who forgives, a God that will use your mistakes for his glory, not yours, for his glory. Why? Because why? He will put you in a situation whereby Glenn or Vi can be doing something and to hear something, and God says, speak to them. And if you know his voice and your answer is yes in advance, I tell you what, God will anticipate victory. God will use you as tools and sharpen you, so that now you can be used for God's glory. So that's really important. Even, get this, your feelings, okay? You have to overcome your feelings. Even when you don't want to read his word, read. Even when you don't want to serve, serve. Even when you don't want to come to church, come to church. Even when you don't want to just wake up, get up. Allow God to use you. Overcome that. Even when you don't want to pray, pray and listen. Really listen, because God wants to speak to you. And you hear God with your heart, not your ears. It can be all summed up, as I close, in Proverbs 3, 5, and 7. Everyone knows this. Okay? Let me put a new perspective. Go here. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Not here. And not lean on your own understanding. Go here. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Warning, don't go here. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Cool, yeah? When you start to understand it. During our blunder experience, God often leads us to amazing, amazing discoveries about ourselves and our character, who we are. What we say and who we are, sometimes totally different. Okay? We can speak Christianese, we can do this, but yeah, and you know it, yeah? Sometimes you're saying something in the middle of saying something and you tell in yourself, you said, you know what, you're such a waha, you're so bulay, you. Okay, you don't believe what you're saying. Yeah? That kind of stuff. And you know, you hear all kind of advice to so many people. But what is God saying to you? What is God saying to Sydney, to Bob, okay, to Francis, to Takai? What is He saying to you? You know what He's saying? I love you. Okay? Get up. Get up. Just one more round. Remember this, failure is never final unless you make it that way. Blunders can be turned into blessings in disguise. God never wastes a hurt. There are other hidden treasures if you dig deeper. If you dig deeper, there's got to be something good out of all of this. It, you know, it's just like this story about this two children. Okay, one positive child, one negative child. Okay, he put a negative child, they put him in a classroom, gave him all kinds of good stuff, anything that he wanted. Okay, he gave him a pony. He said, so what do you want? Oh, you want food? What do you want? Oh, you want movies? You want DVDs? Terrific, right? Da, 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 da. And he comes back, this child, everything is broken. Everything is broken. And he's crying, is this all we have? Da, 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 da. Okay, they put this other child, okay, they put him inside this room over here, okay, with all horse manure, okay, stinky stuff. After a while, he's just throwing horse manure all over the place. He says to the child, what are you doing? He said, with all of this horse doodle, there got to be a pony here someplace. Got to dig deeper, okay? Your messes in life can be a message for you. What is God saying to you through this message today? This is really, really important because, you know what, blessings can be elusive if you don't know what you're looking for. It lies the need to surface blunders are oftentimes, again, blessings in disguise. It's like looking for taco. Looking, no, if you don't know how to look for octopus or taco, you'll never see them. Okay? But when you know, he put tain in the water, he knows what he's looking for. He goes, ooh, plenty of taco all over the place. Why? He trained his eyes to see the blessings, not the bummers. Make sense? So what is God showing you and what is God saying to you through the message today? When we make mistakes, okay, this is what God wants to do. Be still. Listen. Learn. Trust. Obey. And apply what I tell you to do. So if you look at your notes, there's some reflection questions here. Okay, let me put a quote. Sometimes people with the worst pasts can create the best futures. Think about it. What does this quote mean to you? Do you have the past blunders that can be turned into blessings? How can you redeem your past mistakes to create a better future for you and for those God places in your life? Think about that. Search, pray, ask God. Remember, closing, don't go here. Insanity means going back to your vomit, doing the same things over and over and over again, and working harder and harder at the same things that don't work will drive you crazy. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your word. We thank you that your promises are true, that our blunders can be turned to blessings if we allow the Word of God to penetrate our hearts. So, Father, we ask for a changed heart, a changed mind, and a changed future, because you love us so much that all of our blunders, all of our sins was put under the blood of Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. Father, for those who are struggling with blunders in their life, would you just have them accept the truth that their sins are forgiven? That the blood of Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross erased their blunders, Father, and turned them into blessings. I lift up my brothers and sisters in my left and right. Would you give them a revelation and a deeper understanding? Let them listen to the Holy Spirit's voice as he says, come and follow me. I will make you fishers of men. I will change your heart to be more like Jesus. That's our goal, Father. For those of us who are just don't want to let go of our past, Father, help us. With Christ, all things are possible. We tried everything that we know how, physically, emotionally, spiritually, but we haven't trusted you with all of our hearts. Our blunders belong into your hands, and you will transform that into a metamorphosis that from ugliness, it will turn into butterflies of blessings. So we thank you. We'll lift up our brothers and sisters who aren't here for some reason or another, for Scotty and Nadine as they go across the Molokai Channel, Father, would you protect them with your grace and your mercy and give them such a revelation of the beauty of Christ in the channels between Molokai and Oahu. For Heidi, Father, that she represents you at the wedding and bridal expo, Father, that she will be a light that shines so brightly that glorifies her Father, that you put people around her that she can pray for, that their lives will change. We pray for Devin and Emily and the team in Bali, Father. They're going through some tremendous, tremendous spiritual battles in the Hindu nation. We want to remind them that no weapons fashioned against them shall prosper. That God is for them, then who can be against them? We pray that for their success, Father. We bind whatever the devil has spiritually trying to come against the Word of God, that there will be a breakthrough there, that Jesus Christ will be preached from all corners of Bali and in the Philippines. We thank you for Byron's heart, Father, that he came back from the Philippines changed because he was convinced of the need and the love of Christ there. For those of us who need Jesus Christ or a special refreshment from the Holy Spirit, I speak that in the name of Jesus Christ to be refreshed today, to be changed, to be renewed, to let go of the past hurts and step into your destiny and to step into your future. I pray for our community, Father, for our friends and our neighbors and our classmates who just don't know you and don't know that they need you, Father. Would you open up opportunities for us to just witness to them? Give us a heart of invitation so that people will come, not to build a church, Father, but to save lives. So I thank you, Lord. Bring many people. Bring many people, because your goal is none shall perish. And for those who are not saved, this is the day. This is the day the Lord has made to rejoice. For today can be the first day of the rest of eternity. If you haven't accepted the Lord Jesus Christ in your life as your Savior, as your friend, as your mentor, as your Lord, this is the day that you can make a change. In the quietness of your heart, all you have to do is not about raising hands, it's about changing your heart. All you have to do is say, Jesus, forgive me for my sins. I need another chance. And God says, you are forgiven. And he'll set another setting at the table in heaven for you for eternity. Jesus, change my heart. For those of you who need a special touch from Jesus, all you have to say is, Jesus, change me. I want to be more like you. So Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the potluck or the pot blessing we're about to receive. Would you bless each and every one of our congregation, Father, with a new understanding, with a spirit of joy, with a spirit of hope, knowing that they are prayed for and loved by you. Jesus Christ loves you, and so do I. I pray for all of you in Jesus' name, and everyone said amen. Amen. Yeah, give God a hand. Thank you, guys. Enjoy each other's company.